quiet Sunday morning in September 1939, wireless radios throughout Northern Ireland crackled with a solemn announcement from Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain.
This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently, this country is at war with Germany.
Like wildfire, the grave news spread across the countryside as families gathered together, feeling in their hearts that life as they had known it would now be changed forever.
Well, I remember well, like yesterday, the day the war broke out, it was on a Sunday, and it was the 3rd of September, 1939. And the first we heard of it was when a neighbour came to our house to tell us that war had been declared. And I remember after that, the Territorial Army, they came and they were camped in a field just at the back of our house. And I think they were training or they were practicing or doing something before they were really called up, you know. And it seemed to be that there was camps all around the countryside, for at night time you could see their searchlights going up into the sky. I remember that well.
Well, I was 7 years old. I can just remember it coming through the radio, and we had to sit very quiet while the news was on, for my father, he was wanted to hear. He was a farmer, so they were exempted from joining. And he wasn't in the war, but I had cousins who joined and friends up the road. And then later on, like, the army was billeted down the plantation from us, and they escorted us up and down the road where we were going in and coming out from school. And there was an Air Force base then just down the road, and they had the different wee huts out in the fields, like, to where they communicated. And when the army was in manoeuvres, they stayed in our yard, and some of the officers slept in our spare bedroom. And I can remember the big boxes of cream cracker type biscuits they used to give us. And my sister, one of the soldiers' wives, she was very big with my sister. She always kept in touch with her until the war ended, and then we lost touch after that.
When I heard that sound, I was getting up to go to Sunday school. And I was up in the bathroom having a shave, and all, and my mother called me down for my breakfast. And when I came down, my mother says, "Did you hear that, James?" She says, "That's Mr. Chamberlain on," and he says, "England's declared war on Germany." And then they started to tell us all about what all was going to be closed.
I actually was in Sunday school, and my parents came to meet us and told us. And of course, we didn't really understand. I was about 9 at the time, so I didn't understand what was happening, but I knew it was a very sad thing that they were telling us.
I can remember the blackouts, and there was just a tiny wee speck. It was battery lamps usually you had in your bicycles.
Carbide.
And our carbide. And there was just a wee speck to let you see along the road. And, like, I don't know how on earth they... Of course, there were no cars then, as what, you know, now. But, and we had to keep our windows, the blinds, the blackout blinds and all, and the windows.
It just gives you some idea of how dark it was in the blackout. And the sirens had gone off, and our ARP post was just across, obliquely across the street from where I lived. And as soon as it went off, I opened the door and dashed out to go across. Halfway across the road, I hit something. And for a few seconds, I didn't really know what it was, but it was a policeman coming down to go to the barracks. And I had run into him just in front of his handlebars and his front forks and knocked him clean off the bicycle. And I stepped over him and tore on like mad and hid in the air raid shelter and said nothing about it. And it was quite a topic of conversation about what did this man hit that he come on with. Nobody seemed to know. And until this day, I wasn't intending to tell anybody actually about that. But I'm sure he's long gone.
There was all barbed wire on. You weren't allowed to go on in case of mines, you know, like around Port Rush, Port Stewart, around Ballantoy and around all that direction, you know, was all.
And on round to Limavady to Castle Rock.
Oh, they were? Mm. You know, in case there would be people who were going to mines, that, and, you know, these mines had washed into the shore and all that sort of thing, you know. And still, in some places, they do still come across them yet, in some benign beaches and all them places, they would come across an old mine, you know. Not that very long ago, they discovered one, you know.
Well, the beaches would have been mined anyway.
They would
by
have been,
the British.
Would have been,
the army would have been, mined, you know, the beaches and the wire.
They were, and for a case of landing and all that. Thing, you know.
For, there was always a fear that they would land that way. But there was a bigger fear, I think, that they may have come up from the southern Irish side.
And we're down at McGilligan Beach, owner. You know where McGilligan is, like McGilligan Point, actually. Yeah. And you can see right across Lough Foyle. And we're talking to an old man, owner, as well. And he was telling us, you see, at that time, the Republic of Ireland, or the Free State, as we were calling it then, you see, they were neutral. They remained neutral all the time. And these U-boats come up, and some of them called, and a Greencastle straight across from that point, you know, from McGilligan Point. And he said they could see them quite well, the Germans on the U-boats and all coming in, you know, up the foil.
Well, I was working at that time, although I was only 14, and I had 4 shillings and fourpence a week.
Yes.
That's what my wages were. But
and that's roughly about 22 new pence, wouldn't that be right?
I know, it was very little anyway. But we were, as I was saying before, involved a lot in, with the army and that, because the company, the firm I worked for, we'd done maintenance work around the billets and put up the Nissen huts and all that sort of thing. And one of the trips I used to love was down to the coast near the causeway. I just forget the name of where it was, but they had a post there. And a few huts and things like that. And while I was there, I got climbing up into the observation tower and was handed a pair of binoculars and to keep an eye for the aeroplane coming along. And I thought this was great until a wireless message came over to the sergeant to tell him to get that child out of that box and get the proper sentry up here. He'd been, some officer had been keeping an eye on these guys. They were going up and falling asleep in the box, you know. And the job was to watch for these planes coming about. The British planes that was dropping practice bombs. So for a few weeks I enjoyed being doing that until I got severely reprimanded for being up there. But one of these things that happened.
My memories of that are very vague. There was some stage, I lived at a place called Ballygarvey, and there's a some stage, and I mean to check this out with some of the older gentlemen that still live there. I can remember a bomb in a field about a quarter of a mile up the road from our house, but obviously we weren't allowed near it. But I can remember army there, and I think the plane had actually had to ditch it, and there were wires caught up in the tree, etc., etc., and somebody came and took it away. That's a very early memory.
Early on in the war, the sirens would have went very much whenever the planes were almost on the coast, I'm sure, or maybe even in parts of England, because we were just called out and all the people were all called out. And that gradually, as the war went on, they didn't do it so much like that. You know, if they came up round about Belfast, they would have sort of waited until they got word, and then they would have called us out. But at the beginning, it was 2 and 3 times a night we would have been, they called out, you know.
At school we had the gas mask, like we used to have training, you know, the mock air raids, like, and we got our gas masks on and parade into a certain room or such, and was training if ever there was an air raid, and we didn't know what to do.
Soon after that, I'm not sure how long we had to go and get these gas masks, and we got them a fitting first, and then fortnight later, so you were issued with your gas mask. Those were in a little square box, and you had to carry that to school with you. Every day in life, you took that gas mask to school, and every day at school, they had a wee practice run wearing it for a few minutes to see how you'd get on. It was an awful thing to wear, and I don't think anybody could have kept it on for any length of time. I know I couldn't. About a couple of minutes or so was the most I could do with the gas mask.
What happened if you forgot to bring it?
Well, you got reprimanded and probably got the cane, if it happened too often. And sometimes there was some of the kids that did forget to bring it, and they did get the cane.
I had to wear this gas mask. This is my actual gas mask, with a rubber badly dosed now, and I've tried to maintain it as well as I could, but I've having memories of wearing this gas mask, not trying to fight Adolf Hitler, but trying to make my classmates in my public elementary school laugh, because we had gas mask practice for all the children. And in the largest room in the school, we would go towards the biggest room and be crowded in there, you know, about six or seven classes, all crowded in together. And we'd wear these for afternoon school, the whole afternoon school. After lunchtime, it would be about 1 o'clock or half past one, we would go and sit in the room with a gas mask on for a gas mask practice. And we soon learned that if you made your neighbour friend in another neighbouring desk, and they were very close to neighbouring desks, made that friend, male or female, laugh, that he or she would steam up their window. And so if you made them laugh inside, I'll demonstrate this, shall I? Although this is a bit small for me now because my head has grown since 1940, this, you wore them like this and steamed up the window, you see, and talked and made jokes through it, so your neighbour would laugh violently and then steam up the window, and so soon all the class would be sitting like this with steamed up windows. So that's my memory of this particular model, which I carried in a cardboard box to school every day because of the rules. My little baby brother, Alan, who was born in 1940, by the way, was provided with a kit like this, a complete body-enveloping gas mask thing, and my mother would not use it at all. She was frightened of it, and she wouldn't dream of putting her babies on inside such a monstrosity, as she called it.
When the gas masks were issued, we were really frightened, really, really frightened, not only getting the things on your head. I felt that I was going to stop breathing, you know, whenever, because they were so close and tight around you. And as well as that, when we had drills, you passed just through the air raid shelter, but it was dark and it was cold. And I always remember the cold, dark place that I passed through. We were all right, us girls who were part of a family, but we had a little baby in the family. And the worst thing of all was when her apparatus arrived, she had to be placed in it. And I remember my father having to do it. My mother was so upset that something would happen to Dara whenever she was put into this. And gas masks to me even are a frightening thing.
Each school had a savings group, you know, and it was to help the war effort. You know, the kids were all encouraged to save, and you bought stamps. And there were penny stamps, and you had a card, you see, and you stuck the penny stamps on them, and when you had 15 of those cards filled, then you got a 15 shilling savings certificate, which was worth £1 in 5 years' time, I think it was.
That was some money,
you know,
then.
And that was some money then. And that was the kids all took their pennies to school and bought these stamps, and this lady called one day a week, I forget what day it was, to collect the savings, you know. But it was all pennies, you know. They didn't have anything more than that.
Yeah, there was a collection of, old or second-hand books from home by the government for the war effort. And primary school children were encouraged to bring in as many old books as they could. And there was you got badges to wear according to the number that you brought in. And you rose steadily through the ranks. And I can't remember the number we had to bring, but I scraped our house clean of books to bring them in and got to the rank of general, which was the penultimate rank. Well, notice as field marshal above, I'm very annoyed I never got the field marshal rank. But I brought in literally hundreds of books from my parents' home in Meadowbank Street, on further up Lisburn Road. And the books were stored in two area shelters, which otherwise weren't used, in the school playground. And the two area shelters, as you would imagine a primary school situation, became full of books to the roof inside. They were packed full of books brought in for the war effort. And the children in the school were encouraged to bring in a large number because they were given paper badges to wear according to the rank. I had a red general's badge.
They collected jam pots and tins, as you say, syrup tins and all that type of tins. That was actually the children around the doors and knocked and they got them, you know. But again, you see, there were different things that children was taking part during the school holidays. They went out and helped to gather spuds and helping farms, you know, things like that. Small job, not very heavy work. And they would have been doing jobs like that, you know, working in market gardens, working with vegetables and all that sort of thing, the children, you know.
I think it was a great credit to the women. You know, we didn't seem to have any recollection of problems. My mother always had her dinner on the table and they always had clothes for us and all the rest of it. And sometimes we wonder where they got the stuff they did, and as Maggie says there, that they improvised all the time. But they were doing this all the time. And for everything, for clothes, for food. And as I say, it was a great credit to the women.
And having these sales of work to help the war effort, you know. So they would have these sales of work, they'd have, old clothes and all that sort of thing, you know, Nick. And they would have these sales of work and they would also have jumbled sales and all that sort of thing, you know, Nick, going on to keep for the effort, you know, war effort.
They used to come in an army lorry, you know, to the farm at the harvest time or at the, for the digging of spuds and things like that, you know, and they did work hard at that time. I can sort of remember them coming, but they worked in maybe a 12 or so of them came in an army lorry, you know, and they worked maybe for a week at a farm and then they went on to another farm. But then there were some of them employed or stayed on the farm, you know, maybe a couple of girls, and they would have stayed maybe for a year, maybe for a year and a half or more, you know. They employed them, they were sent to help because the men folk were away and there was no farm labourers to do the job.
Well, that was posted all right round Ballymoney on telegraph poles so that the people could read it, you know, and it was more or less telling people what to do, you know, during the war years, you know.
We had coupons for clothes. I mean, mothers did a lot of knitting and did a lot of making clothes. And also in the whole way of housekeeping, I mean, they, like I told you about how they remedied not having the actual article, but by producing it, by adding something to it. My own mother never stopped knitting for us. And we were, as I say, fortunate to live in a country that we had a big vegetable garden and we were able to supply those and some of the evacuees which came to live around us.
My father would listen to Radio Éireann a lot, and I heard a lot of radio, that's Irish radio programmes after the war. He was very keen on that. He had been a student in Dublin, in a teaching college in Dublin, and he got a feeling for Dublin things. So we often listened to Radio Éireann because I can also remember my mother didn't like to listen to Lord Haw-Haw on the radio, the propaganda man, William Joyce, is it William Joyce? And my father would listen to that, hear what the propaganda was saying. My mother said, turn that thing off, Bob, turn that thing off. She didn't like the sound of William Joyce.
The thing that's most vivid to me, we were coming home from school one day, and I remember seeing the two parachutes coming down, and the plane crashed over about Ballyrock over here, which is Ballyrock's a townland that's about halfway between here and Port Rush. Mm-hmm. And I remember us coming up the road from school, and we could see the two parachutes coming down. It's the first time we'd ever seen a parachute. We didn't really realise what it was, you know, at the time. But the plane crashed somewhere over there about Ballyrock. It wasn't too far away. I remember that well.
I heard them that night, the Belfast was blitzed. You know, you'd heard them going over, you know, with that screechy sort of sound. It was a different sound from you'd get there from a British plane, you know.
That was a sort of a drone.
A kind of drone. That's right, sort of drone.
Different sound from
very screechy sort of sound.
That's right, yeah.
You know. And we knew there must have been something on, and the next day we discovered that Blitz Belfast, you know. The docks and all right around that area, you know. Took it very badly there, you know.
But I was a young apprentice joiner at the start of the war, just 14, and very, very shortly after the war was commenced, they formed the ARP, Air Precaution, and the joiners and the bricklayers within the building firm, the Hugh Taggart's whom I was working for, were formed into the rescue squad, heavy rescue squad, and I was taken along as their runner. So at 14 and a half, I was issued with a steel helmet, which made me think that I was the best soldier in the British Army. But it got me involved in that type of thing. And we had some great exercises and things like that. Even went to Belfast at the Blitz. But I wasn't allowed to get off the lorry because it was so small. They were afraid of losing me, I think.
See, I was at the school at the time, up at the old technical school in Ballymoney, and it was on such a thing as called the ATC, which was called the Air Training Corps. And quite a lot of us know all the pupils was involved in that, the men pupils. And they came along and asked us would we go up to do rescue up in Belfast. So we went up to more or less look for bodies and all that type of thing, you know, because the hospital was fairly crowded with, you know, people that we were injured and all that sort of thing, you know. It was a terrible sight to see that, you know, just shortly after the, you know, the Blitz, you know.
You must have been very young at the time.
Well, I was very young, I was about 16 or that, 16 or 17 at the time, you know. And it was a terrible, like, you've never seen a disaster like that on that scale, you know, like, until you've seen that, you know. And it was very frightening as well as, you know, seeing the people, you know. People have been homeless.
I do remember some evacuees. There was a farmer lived across the road from us, Tatesforth, Alec Campbell, and there was evacuees came there. I remember playing with them on our school days, like, you know. And I think there might be one or two about yet. I think there's Tommy Mibbin, was he an evacuee? I'm nearly sure he was.
Alec's wife, Agnes.
Oh, Agnes. Oh, aye. Well, I didn't know her, but I can remember Tommy and Harry Mibbin. Or he's dead and gone now, but Tommy's still there on a farm up the Vow Road.
Well, because I started school just in October of 40, I was not part of the evacuation. And I suddenly went out on the street to play with neighbour children and couldn't find any. Because all the neighbour children had been evacuated, and I wandered several local streets trying to find somebody to play with. Our children were out in the street, and they weren't any there. So I came back home disappointed with nobody to play with, and even more disappointed when there was no chocolate, no ice cream, and no bananas. The important needs for a five-year-old boy, as you know. There was ice cream available if one walked further up Lisburn Road as far as the King's Hall. I thought there was, because there was an ice cream cone sign outside a shop up near the King's Hall, and I would get my parents to walk me the length of Lisburn Road, maybe about a mile, to get to the King's Hall, to try to, maybe 2 miles, to try to find if there's ice cream in the shop that had the cone outside. And I would do that on almost a weekly basis in the holiday time. And there was never ice cream inside because there wasn't ice cream. I missed that badly.
The first day the sweets were rationed, my sister started work, and that was July 1942. These are ration books issued during the war. As you know, the food was all rationed. As far as I can remember, it's about half a pound of sugar you got per week, per head, and something like the same in butter. And eggs was rationed too. We had dried eggs, which we made into scrambled egg. And we also had coupons for clothes. You weren't able to buy clothes unless you had these coupons. And, well, it may have bought you one rig out in a year. And we had all these other coupons then for the different things that you needed. Some here for the butcher, and the eggs, fats, cheese, bacon and sugar. Milk, well, we were lucky for we had our own cows and we had our own milk and butter. But we all learnt to live with what we got, and we seemed to be fed pretty well.
I remember vividly rationing, and about the butter especially, because 1 week we got 2 ounces and the next week we got 4. And my mother, there was a large family of us, and it was rationed out. And also the sweet coupons, which were given to us, and we had to sort of make that do a month. And there were E's and D's, and the E's were more valuable than the D's. And I suppose a child of 9 and 10 and whatever, those are the things that affected us. I also remember when the butter was scarce, we had a farm near to us, and we went every week for buttermilk for our mother baking. But maybe once a month, the farm lady made country butter, and she put it in a can and put a lid on it. And she said, "Now, don't let anyone see that, because we're not supposed to do it."
3/4 of a pound of sweets you were allowed per month. But some people, whether they hadn't the money to buy the sweets or not, you could always have bought a coupon or two, you know, from somebody that would, if you had the money to buy it, you know, it's difficult getting money in those days. But I remember, that's one thing I do remember clearly, was the coupons for the sweets. D's and E's. The D's were worth 1/4 of a pound, the E's were worth 1/2 a pound.
What else was rationed?
Everything was rationed. Everything was rationed.
Well, tell us about that. Anybody else remember?
Butter, margarine, sugar, the whole thing was rationed. It was a small amount that even meat was rationed.
If you kept bees, you got your ration with sugar, you were, you know, for it to feed the bees with, you know. I remember my aunt, she kept a lot of bees, and they would always be able to plenty of sugar from her, you know.
We lived in the country, and during the fruit season and the harvest, with apples and plums and damsons, we did very well. But even tinned fruit was very scarce. I remember tinned plums were a luxury.
Oh, yeah.
Not
syrup and all that,
like a pineapple or anything like that, you know.
Whenever you couldn't have got white flour, they talked about the national bread. Do you remember that? And it was sort of, they called it black bread, but it wasn't really black. You know, it was brown, but it wasn't the lovely brown bread that you could buy today. It was terrible stuff, terrible stuff. And that was all there was. Everybody was the same. The bread was like there was husks through it or something. You know, you'd have thought.
My mother was a great baker, and they did quite a lot of things. And one of them I remember, when she baked cakes and wanted to fill them, she filled them with a cream that was made from a parsnip, and it was flavoured with banana. And it was really nice. It was really nice. And so she filled her cakes with that. And also we got a ration of dried eggs, powdered eggs, which we used quite a lot as well. Some people didn't like them. I quite liked them, an omelette.
It wasn't too bad. See, we were farmers, and we had our own eggs and potatoes. But I can remember the skip. Up sugar on her tea. Since then, I haven't taken sugar. And there were no sweets or anything like that that I can remember much like. And I can remember my mother making jelly with, was it carrageen moss? Made lovely jelly. And you couldn't get jelly, but I can remember her making this. And it tasted lovely. And was it parsnip? What was it now? Parsnip and something else you made, and that was like a type of butter. But on the whole, we weren't too bad.
The only secrets were trying to get food in the black market and that sort of thing. You know, that's a thing that some of the farmers used to do. You know, at this time of the year, they would have killed a pig illegally. And they would have shared it out amongst their neighbours, you know. Mm-hmm. And that
you don't know the name of that farmer, do you?
I do know one of them, yes. But the meat was cured by putting it in salt or something like that. Do any of you remember that?
Yeah,
And that was how they got their bacon, you know. They weren't allowed to do it, you know. It was done hush hush.
My father was also a butcher, and there was a farmer down by Kilbream that was not.
Family of eight, and during this rationing, I wasn't too bothered with the rationing, no, because it wasn't my problem, and I got plenty of sweets because somebody in the house didn't like them or something like that, and the food went well. We had friends who were farmers and friends of the family, and we used to get the odd rooster, and this terrified me because at the back of the door, as you were going out to the back, under a cloth, this big rooster would have been hanging of feathers and all on it. And my mother would pluck it. And this, I didn't like that at all. I couldn't have this end of it at all.
Rabbit was very much, was nearly better than chicken, you know,
mm-hmm.
at that time.
Yeah.
It was just lovely.
Mm-hmm. Well, you were lucky if you knew someone that do a bit of shooting and get you a rabbit.
That's right. But then, you see, like everything else, they got scarce, you see.
Oh,
they weren't as plentiful, you know, because people were using them more.
And then there was a big lot of land taken up by the army.
There was, that's right, a lot of land taken up by the army. And
Leslie Hill and all.
Once the army took over the land, then that was, you couldn't trespass on, you know, you couldn't go on to anywhere where the army was.
There's sort of a local manor house around where I lived. That was full of people from Gibraltar. They were up there, you know, it's an old house. And I can remember an aeroplane actually crashing up in there, just another side of an open house. But I remember that right enough. As regards the food there, you know, there's a lot of smuggling on here as well, you know, went over the border to the Free State there and got a lot of dead stuff that we hadn't got. And, stuff that they needed, you know, sort of things. There's a lot of that went on, you know, butter and I remember stockings and all stuff like that was all smuggled and all. Butter and tea and sugar.
You're talking there about spies. Now, an interesting thing I'd heard about a spy was a tour head and around the head in Antrim. There was this man who was caught by one of these portable wirelesses, and he was transmitting to the Germans information connected with different landings and all that sort of thing. And I think he was arrested. It appeared in the Northern Whig. That was, I think it's now the newsletter, isn't it?
Yeah,
and the Corian Chronicle about him, you know. So that's the only thing I ever heard about, you know, any spies.
Well, Derry was a big naval base. And
that's right.
That was big. The Atlantic War was on very. The war with the merchant seamen, and Derry would have been the first landfall for those, and that's where the frigates and that would have worked out of as well, so anything they would capture, they would have brought them into there.
There was also a prisoner of war camp at Cookstown, and that was a large one. And I remember, I only knew about it later on, you know, I didn't know about it at the time, but one of the German prisoners made a clock entirely out of wood, and that clock is still ticking away in people called Getty. Man Redmond Getty got that clock, and he still has it. And it's made entirely out of wood, and nothing else but wood, and the works is wood. Made by a German, by a ball and put it into large piles, all lying, rusted and rotten, you know, and weeds growing up through it. And that area is now a large housing estate, where the prisoner of war camp was.
There was a prisoner of war camp at Loch Gill during the Second World War, and it was also there during the First World War, you know. That was there, you know, I knew about that area. I don't know then, but I know it since then, you know. Oh, that's right. Fairly big prisoner of war camp it was too, I think.
Did you know who was there?
German, mainly.
We used to have to go up there and do some repairs and just from. And I personally was amazed at the things these fellas were making out of old bits of wood and they were carving. And one of the things they did make was they carved a sort of a chicken, put it on a flat board. Its head was able to move like that because they put a string down through it and a stone on it. And when you shook it like this, this done no. That. And these lads were doing well, next to nothing. You knew they weren't allowed any carving tools, obviously, or any knives. And this was one toys like that. And they were quite pleasant lads, you know. They didn't know what we were saying. We didn't know what they were saying, so it didn't really matter. But they were there, quite happy.
I was attending a wedding where a friend of mine getting married in Loch Gill Parish Church. He said, come on over and have a yarn with these prisoners. I was terrified, you know, I don't know what to do, where to go or not, you know, knowing all about the Nazis and all that sort of thing. Well, anyway, I decided to go across, he persuaded me to go across. And as he says, they're all along the barbed wire. They're talking, you shook hands with you, tipping nice people, you know. Nice. And they always kept in the pocket and they always done like that there, you see, and I got an idea, maybe a cigarette, you see. And eventually they had to point in where the guard was away up, you see. He got the way maybe up and then I done like that and put it in and given the cigarettes. And he gave me a lovely nice wee lighter. No, a cigarette lighter with their swastika, you know, a syrup tin. They got all these old syrup tins and old salmon tins and all that and made all these different wee ornaments all out of them, you know.
Right.
And that's what I know about the prisoners at Loch Gill.
I found that it was the class above me that went. You know, the boys, say, 2 years older than me, would have been 17, 18 when I was 14, 15. But a lot of them went to the Air Force and became rear gunners and the bombers going over Germany. And a lot of them didn't come back. And some of them were people I knew very well.
Four worked on a firm in Corrine Young's in Mount Sandal, they grew mushrooms and tomatoes. I was a van driver there. They were forming a TA battery in Corrine. That was a Korean 6 light aircraft battery. And I remember we decided, four of us, to join up. So we went over to the courthouse in Korean. We went up there. Now, I was only 17 at the time. But they asked me when I was born, and I had the presence of mind to say, right, the 7th of the 11th, 1920, which made me 18 and a half.
One young man, Gary McClellan, across the street from me in Charlotte Street, and he had joined and had become a navigator on the bombers. And in one of the flights, either going or coming back from Germany, the pilot had been killed. and Jerry had managed to bring the plane and had landed it, and for that he had got an award. And shortly after that, in another series of bombing raids, he himself had been killed. So that was a tragedy. I mean, he just lived across the street. We knew him. We all knew him very well.
I went away first, along with another chap. We got on two bicycles. We went to a place called Kilray to the recruiting sergeant there. And then I was going to join the Skins, my father's old regiment. And we went in. We'd done the tests and everything. Another chap was with me, and he failed. We went out and talked to him. And drank a cup of tea, and he looks at me and says, "I know your father." I says, "You do?" I says, "He's a postman, isn't he?" I said, "Yes." And he says, "When were you born?" And I says, 12/7/22. He says, "Get out." He says, "You're too young." He says, "Come back in the time." So then I went to work. I've got a job at work. I listened to my father talking about one thing and another. He was brought to Gallipoli, and the Marines brought him out. And he's talking about the Marines. And there and then I decided, when I was old enough, I did. And that's how I joined the Marines.
I, unfortunately, was too young, or I would have been away. In fact, my friend Bill McComb and I went, instead of going to work one day, we went to Belfast, being there for the first time, and asked our way to the recruiting place in Houston Street, Belfast, to join the Navy. Because we were 16, and we had read in the local books that an electrician became an officer, and Bill was an electrician, and a carpenter, I was a joiner carpenter, became a pilot. So I said, "This is for us, Bill. We are in the Navy." And we went and knocked the door, and this massive big petty officer, whatever he was, came out and asked us what we wanted, and I said we wanted to join the Navy. And he says, "Away home." And I said, "No, here to join the Navy. He's an electrician, I'm a carpenter, and we want to join the Navy." So I remember as well, they put his hand on my head like that and turned me round and hit me a kick. And then said, "It's fine, well, now it's one home to your mother." And in broad Ballymoney, I said, "I'm not with my ma at all. They join here. I joined the Navy." He says, "Well, go and join the Army."
Good.
No, I says, "If I can't get on the Navy, I'm joining
nothing.
I'm going back." So we made our way very disgruntled. We waited the train and went home, and we decided the British didn't want us. We joined the Home Guard.
That's my soldier's paybook, the brown one. And the other one is the release book when I was demobbed.
So how much did you get paid when you were a soldier?
When I went, we spent about 10 months in Scotland, and I wasn't married, but it was 14 shillings a week. Now I made a commitment of 3 and 6 months out of that to home. It was 10, 6 months a week, that was 52 pounds. Not right.
If you were going in fighting lightly, all you carried was a side pack and your toilet gear, and that was all you carried. You were doing raids. You didn't have any big when you were doing a raid. It was as light as you could. You had your ammunition around your and your pouches, and that was it. But not what. When you're moving about, all that was on your body. You done 2 hours of parade with that on you. So, by the time you finish, you're fishing.
You must remember this. The Army has got to be a disciplined force, because if you could imagine, we're here in a hole in the ground, and 20 yards from us, in a hole in the ground over there, is a fully armed enemy. We have got to pass them to do something, to clear a road or to help some other section come through. Yeah. And the sergeant at the end says, ready after three we go.
Mm-hmm.
And he blows his whistle.
That's
and nobody
right.
moves. Nobody. And see, nobody moves. I mean, you might as well put the flag up. Those young men have got to go through all that awful training yes. so that whenever the word comes to do something, they automatically do it. And the British Army being the best army in the world, they are well trained, but yes. it is cruel.
It's cruel and it's a
it's
tough
cruel,
life.
But tough it's not for everybody.
I just thought we were blooming great heroes going into battle. We didn't have a care in the world. We were young and foolish. When we arrived in Calais, we were to go to the citadel in the centre of Calais, and we had a gun there, and we mounted and about three stories high, commanding a road about 600 yards away, and we were able to watch them and keep them back in the tower. For 72 hours, we never slept. Not wanting to sleep. Hardly anything to eat. We never had time. Only I'd drink tea. A couple of buds sitting back like, making tea. And that's all we'd done. And we eventually, on Saturday, we were told to move position. And we got down and got up through the town. We had a street fighter way through the town. There was a Saxon with us. I was carrying a tripod of a Vickers gun, and another chap was carrying the barrel, and another boy was carrying the water. And we eventually got through, and we took up near the beach, head facing towards Dunkirk. And we stayed there until the Sunday evening, until we were captured. I'd been sitting behind a machine gun, and the sergeant out there, come up, Paddy, there's can we get some? I got up from the gun and walked away from the gun. And as I walked away from the gun, something hit the gun and I got a lump of shrapnel in the back of the leg. I never thought anything about it. I never did anything. But I went to sit down with the gun again. If I hadn't got up when I did get up, I'd have been right through the back. So he said, the luck of the Irish you get, he said, look. That was that. So I was very lucky I did. And nobody ever knew, even the wife. I never told my wife I was grappling on the leg. So it's not a thing to say when you get it in the back, it may sound strange, but if you get anything in the back, the most of servicemen, you're a coward. You really run or you do something you shouldn't.
So you were embarrassed.
And I just lucky. I got up to take a cup of tea. Eventually, around about 4 o'clock on the Sunday evening, there's a field telephone line close by, and it started ringing. And the boy left it and asked to surrender. That was from the British officer down in the town. So because there was no officer there. Sergeant, an officer come up, he says, oh, he says, we got the word, we have to surrender. He says, some flight white flag up. Order the sergeant. The sergeant says, no. He says, I'm ordered to go up there and put the fight up. And he walked up, he threw his revolver and shot him through the head. But before he'd done that, he said, death before dishonor. That was that. And the next thing, was the Germans coming out like ants out of the sandhills. And one of them is only a little squirt of bloke, but he's about this width across his shoulders. Came up and he says, what regiment are you? I said, don't know. What? What regiment are you? Don't know. And he spoke perfect English. Well, I know what regiments are on. He said, I can see it on your buttons, on the rings. So then he says, what are you going to do? He said, what can we do? You're the boss now. He says, well, sit down there and sit there. You're told to stand up. That was it. Sat there from 4 o'clock to 7 that evening. And at 7 o'clock, the they'd move us. So before we moved, we destroyed the guns. And I ran a revolver, machine gunner carried a 5. And we were walking around with a chap as well, and he said, well, I said, Paddy, what are we going to do with these? And I said, well, we're going to destroy them, aren't we? He says, we came across a little iron bridge leading in. We pulled the revolvers out and broke them over the iron rail and threw the rest of the water. And this wee boy came up and says, oh, you're good soldiers, because you destroyed your weapons. And he says, what are we going to do? And he says, you're going for a long march. Won't be a long march. So we started us out through the town. At about 9 o'clock that evening, it was into a small church. Is this is where you stay the night. And this other chap and me, it was my chum, went into the church. And I slept in the pub, he slept on the steps. That was the first sleep we got. And the boys were sleeping on the gravestones, and gravestones on top of them all around. This morning, about 5:30, they got us on the move, and they moved us. And they moved us. It was a forced march. Nothing to eat. And we thought, well, they're heading towards. They marched us north. But no, they didn't. They marched us southeast. And in about a week, they come back to where I'd rather been in Cali, near Cali. The old soldiers that were with them seemed to have got lost somewhere. But that week, a farmer was very, very sorry he ever seen it, because the new spuds were just formed on the drills of a field. And there wasn't a spud left in it when we had finished. We left all the spuds out of it. And the next day, it was a hedge. You thought a herd of goats would have went along. Pulled all the leaves off and ate the leaves. All we got to, they didn't feed us. Now, in the event they did set up field kitchens, it was sauerkraut and sauerkraut and sauerkraut. That's all it was. After you had nothing in your stomach for about a week, the sauerkraut didn't stay very low. The farmer had a good crop of grass. And well, first of all, we'd done 3 weeks marching right through France, Belgium and Holland. But a funny thing that did happen to us, about the 9th or 10th day, none of us had a wash, a bath or anything. And it took us through this, into this forest to come onto a road. And right in, almost in the middle of the forest, was a village. A blooming great wide, deep stream flowing through the centre of it. Well, we saw water, or we made for the water. Some of the boys stripped off, took it off. Some of them, I went before the uniform on. Some of them stripped off, and I tell you, there were some very embarrassed ladies come out of houses. I never saw so many naked men all over the place. We marched on in into Belgium, and then into Holland. When we got into Holland, we're going along the road to a convent, and the nuns came along with us. There was a lot of wire on it, and they came along, and they were offering us cigarettes and bread and things like that, and talking to them. And we give them messages. Well, some of the messages got through from that, because that one's got the message got home. And we moved on from there, and we come to this place that was near Maastricht in Holland. The blooming great cigarette factory. A lovely place it was. A crowd of the girls came down. They were throwing cigarettes over. I didn't smoke with me. The boys were going getting cigarettes. And ones up top were throwing cigarettes down to them, and they were throwing them. The Germans opened up with machine gun along the top window. Don't know whether they killed me. Some bound to have killed some girls. They just opened up, and that was it. Come to into Germany. I went down this narrow road. There's a bridge at the bottom. And then I had to go over this bridge, big bridge. It's a I would just forget the name. It was Minor Ridge or something like that. Or anyway, we were stopped at this bridge, and there's a little house along the road side, and the people come out. We were sitting there. They brought out milk and wine and water. And there was two girls in particular we noticed with bread and all. They came over and started talking to us. They spoke English. The two of them spoke English. And one of them was very heavily pregnant. And a German soldier came out and he told them to get away. They said no. They wanted to give us bread. He turned around and kicked her in the stomach. And she went down. She was not unconscious. A German officer came over. We rang the guard. We didn't care. We rang the guard. This German officer in the motorbike said, "Can't come along." He'd have been tore to bits because there were some big men there. There were a lot of ones, parents themselves, like only young. The officer came along and asked us what happened, and we told him. He made the boys stand at attention, and he hammered up to the ground with a baton. And he just stood there and took it. He couldn't do a thing. We didn't know what happened after that. They put him in the back of a wagon and took him away. The first camp we went into was about a mile in the middle of a swamp. When you're walking into it, you could feel you're going up and down like this. Talk about mosquitoes, flies. We're only there one night. Marched in the next morning. Took us into a railway siding. Along came the cattle trucks. They just started herding them in, you know, pushing them in. Got into these cattle trucks. They bunged you in. You couldn't all sit down or lie down at the same time. You stand. They took it in turns. One half sit down and rest, and the other. And you were there all that day and right in through the night. They never got out. We had one man died in that. There was one man died. And they let us the next morning, that one morning, and the Red Cross came along. And the guards chased the Red Cross. They wouldn't let the Red Cross give us anything. So it just showed you that they were the masters. The Red Cross, they apologised, like some of them could speak English, they apologised. They had to do what they were told. So back on the... And 3 days and three nights we were in those wagons. And altogether there were six people died in different wagons. And they just took the bodies out and maybe left two men worth of bodies. But we don't know what happened to that. First job I got was in a coal mine.
Where was that?
In East Sudetenland, a place called Peterhoven. And the mine was about 2 miles deep. And I was in the third floor. Down. And instantly, the German that was with me had a name, something similar. So he was a Baumer or something. And nobody, he was a man about 65. And he took me along, he went in. When you went down the shaft, you got out. He took in a small train fare, like, and about maybe a mile. And he got out, and he climbed maybe 18, 20 feet up a ladder. To the seam that you're going to work in. And the seam, when you get up, and it was only about 18 inches high, 18 inches to 2 foot high. And you had to crawl about 400 yards to the face, the coal face. And so just him and me, and that was there. And you had it around your waist, and there was hooks on it. And when you got to the top, he hooked two pit props on this side and this side. And you took these pit props with you. He was always leading, and if he heard a crack, he'd come, and I'd fall. A pit prop had broken, and he got on. You'd take a prop off and put it in, and then when you got to the cold face, it was about 9 foot high. You were able to stand up, but when the wall come down, there's a shaker. And when it comes down, you're only able to lie on your side. The way the coal comes down, they shovel it into the shaker. And you done that for 12 hours. It always 12 hours with a very thin slice of sawdust bread, as we called it, and a flask of coffee. You know, you'd do it at 6 o'clock in the morning. And sometimes you're lucky if you're back up at 9 o'clock in the evening. And when you get back up, you went and had a shower, took you back to the billet, and they presented you with a plate of sauerkraut or a plate of potato soup, as they called it. That's what you got to eat. I was sent on the, from Chatham Barracks. Mrs. Annie Balmer, Ballymoney County Antrim, Glenstow, Northern Ireland, regret to report that your son, Chatham X3100, Marine William Balmer, is missing. That was a telegram. Commandant of Royal Marine Chatham Barracks said that. So that was on the 9th of June. But she already got one before that. I was killed in action. But that was the one that livened her up a bit. These prisoner of war books, my mother got them every so often. 1942, I think, was the first one she got. And all the photographs and write up or in them were stage managed by the Germans. You had to say what they said. You're alive and well, and you're doing well, working, but you never told them where you were working. You just told them what type of work you're doing. Coal mines, farms, railways, hospitals, one place and another, laying railway lines, all the rest of it. And you don't mention a name, because half the letter then was wiped out. Tell them the name of the camp you were in, the 8B, Stalag 8B. That was the biggest camp in Germany. When I went to it first in 1940, I think there was about 14,000 to 17,000 prisoners already in it. And they put us into, marched us in, and went into, put you into a billet, or a big barrack room. In the room I went into, there was 150 men in that room. And I was there all the summer. And when we left it, when I went out of it to go to work, there was nearly 200 people in it. They knew all the people.
Anyone ever tried to escape from there?
There was three, not from there, not from the main camp. But in the main camp, that was what we called the hell hole. They got nothing. The only people who got anything there were the people who worked in the medical blocks and the cookers, the galleys. But the other boys never got anything. And I went out to the coal mines in December 1940. When I left that, there was a crowd of men that were chained together. I don't know how many there was, but they were chained together at the ankles. And no matter where they were, the other had to go, and there was about 3 to 4 foot of snow on the ground, and you could see them try to walk to get through the snow. And we thought we were bad, but we don't know what they'd done to deserve that, but there must have been about 30 or 40 of them. If you worried, thought too much about it, there was no hope for you. Some boys were really ill, went to hospital, or probably remained in the hospital for the rest of the time they were there. They got so depressed they couldn't do anything. But we had one little chap, a Scotchman, in one of the places we were working in, a Hollis factory. And he decided it was time he got home. And we thought, how are you going to get home? They'll just have to wait the same as the rest of us to liberate it. And he says, I'll get home. So the first thing he tried to do was burn the factory down. We caught him in time. He tried to burn the place down. Got him. Things went quiet for a while. And we caught him. We watched him one night, measuring a thing on a bench, a pendulum saw, a big pendulum saw, and it came out like that. And he measured his own height, his own length, so it cut his head off. We cut his head off. And he had it worked out. He pulled this string and pulled himself along with rollers and bring him in line But they saw Paul out at the same time, cut his head off. He went to the, he ended up in Edinburgh Castle. He got repatriated. He was insane. He did go insane. Only a young chap. You see, he let the war worry him. But we got some very nasty letters from his sisters. We let him do it. But we couldn't stop him. He'd made up his mind. There was a Russian soldier that I met when we were going to work, and he joined in and was talking. And I don't know how he knew I was Irish or anything, but he spoke perfect English. And I gave him some potatoes that I had, boiled potatoes and cigarettes. I didn't smoke, but I always got cigarettes from Marines. And I didn't know. And maybe about 6 weeks after that, I met him again, and he gave me these. He said, "That's, thank you very much for the food and the cigarettes." That's how I got them. These are made out of a mess tin, an aluminium mess tin. And the only tools he had to make was bolt, a square-headed bolt and a sharp nail to do the engraving. Hold of that. The contents, three cakes of soap, six razor blades, one shaving soap, two pencils, four pair of socks, two boot polish, one vaseline, one disinfectant, one germaline, one shirt, one towel, one toothbrush, one nail brush. I can't make that one out. Dusting powder, a comb, boot laces, one leather belt. That was sent from the Marines. The Marines put that in. That's what they sent you. It was more or less essential at the time.
I'm the eighth child and the fourth son of a family of nine. My eldest brother, Tom, joined the army about 1938. And he was home on leave. That's the first thing I can remember about him. He was home on leave in March 1940. And he went away on the 26th of March 1940. And he was killed at Dunkirk on the 28th of May 1940. Later, of course. The last memory I have really is the day that he went back. That was on the 26th of March. I remember the entire family was there at that time. I remember the goodbyes and the crying of my mother and my sisters and all, and I wondered what was wrong, why they were crying, because he's going to be, you know. But I remember him gathering up all his stuff, you know, like the army equipment and all that. He had that all with him. And he had it on his back. It was a sort of a haversack, you know. It was bigger than that, you know. And something here in front, like two pouches, you know. I remember that, and a web belt and that sort of thing, you know. But that's what I remember about him, the day that he went away. And that, indeed, was a very sad day, because my mother, she actually cried for days after it, you know. He had letters. He had a gramophone. I remember the old gramophone. It was his master's voice. And we weren't allowed to touch that gramophone at all. Because he wound it up, you know.
On his last trip home, what did he give you?
Pen knife, yes, a small pen knife that I still have it in my pocket here. It's very, very small. And he found that in France, and he gave it to me when he came home on leave at that time. And I have kept it, you know, as a souvenir ever since. There's not much to anything, you know, it's just a small pen knife, but it means a great deal to me, you know. Well, the first thing, of course, was the telegram from the War Office, you know, letting us know that he was missing, presumed killed in action. Then the letter from Buckingham Palace arrived, just a few lines, and signed by King George VI. And apart from that, well, then the medals arrived as well. A couple of medals for his war service, and they arrived sometime later on. Just how long, I'm not absolutely sure. I knew when I come home from school that something was wrong. My mother was crying. My sisters were in a bad way. They crying. And I had no idea what it was. Never even dawned on me that Tommy had been killed or anything like that. And it never even dawned on me. I couldn't understand what was wrong. And I knew that for weeks after that, my mother never was the same. She was weepy, she was crying. Housework, everything seemed to stop, you know, there seemed to be nothing done or anything, you know, about the house. It was just, she was sitting there and she was in sort of a daze, I thought, you know. My father, of course, he was working and somehow or other it wasn't as noticeable with him, you know. He had to keep going on.
Sammy McNabb from Eastmead. And he was a sort of a loner, really. But he went away down into Leslie Hill, where the plantation was, where all of us fellas used to go when we were small. But he would have camped out and was would have hunted rabbits and things like that type of person. He joined the army, and I remember him doing his training, and he got home after, I think it was 6 weeks or something, they did very little training. And he was posted to the London Irish Rifles, and that was it. We never heard another thing about him. And on two occasions, one was we were on holidays, and one of the tours was to a war museum, and I was walking around the headstones, you know, artillery, blah blah blah, and suddenly there was the Royal Irish Rifles, same badge as the London Irish, because they were in that same brigade. And I looked, and there were six names and one corporal, and one of the names was Sammy McNabb. And it was bad, you know. I looked, I couldn't believe my eyes, because that's the first I've ever heard. Some years later, I was a member of the Territorial Army, and part of my duties was to go around the companies and do inspections and repairs of their weapons. And one of the companies was a company made up of the Irish, and I had to go over to London every now and again. And one of the weekends, I was on my own there because they weren't training. I stayed on my own and worked on the weapons. And at night, I went for a wander around the building. And up in the drill hall was this big plaque of all the boys that had been killed. And going in it, there was Sam McNabb's name. So the next morning, I spoke to Sergeant Major about it. And I said, "I believe this, there's a chap up there." Well, he says, "I'll tell you an interesting story about that." He was in the regiment as a rifleman. He said that was a replacement of six riflemen coming up with a corporal down the line to bring them up. As they came up, the Germans started to move the positions, and they took shelter in a shepherd's stone wee building, you know, the sort of thing, and they got a direct hit on their way up to the line. Six recruits and a corporal, and Sam McNabb was one of them. He didn't see much of the war, and it was strange how I'd seen in his name on holiday and then actually got the story of how he had died. Mm. And that really shook me, to be honest, because he was the sort of man would have enjoyed being a soldier, I feel.
Called up, I went to Scotland. 9 months, and then we headed for North Africa. But unfortunately, about August 1940, the Italians came out came into the war in June. So we had to go right round the Cape. It took us 6 weeks before we arrived in 2 years. We went up and down the desert, like rats. We were the desert rats.
What were you afraid of then?
Well, the stickers were dive bombs. You didn't know where the next one was going from. In North Africa, from 1940, we've been right there 3.5 years. Up until Montgomery took charge, we were very, very low on troops on the ground, aircraft, everything. And the stickers just came over, and there was no fighters there to knock. We were on the line to the fence. Until Montgomery took charge, up the Air Force, they built up the troops on the ground, and it was really, we were up and down the desert, God knows how many times. We were up the salt flats, and once we got there, we bogged down, and the Germans took us back, and then we reformed and chased them up again. It was like, we ran old Jack of York. But finally, Alameen was the turning point in the war. We were going about 400 miles in the desert to take a fort. I think it was either Jalo or, I think it was Jalo. The tiles were in there and they were holding this oasis it was. And we were in the South African Brigade at the time. One of our gun carriers, the lorry that pulled the gun, that broke down. So we had to detach the gun and onto another vehicle. And we were left then with a 5-ton truck pulling the gun carrier, which had broke down. And all of a sudden this ME-110 came, spotted us, but we were away behind. The trip went on without us. They didn't know for a long time that we were, this was the ambulance. So we circled around, and there was an old fellow, Paddy Toner, from Ringsend, poor in here. And there was the driver and the bombardier and the truck. We were pulling this gun carrier. So we said, right, bail out. So we bailed out, and we started on for cover. There was no cover at all. There wasn't even one bit of weed. So we thought, well, wait until he comes in. What side he's going for? So we did on the right-hand side. And that thing was just stream of bullets come up past us. And unfortunately, old P didn't make it out of there. His foot got caught in the wheel. And that was the nearest ever I was to being killed. The temperature during the day would maybe rise to 90 or 100. This is out, and there was no vegetation or no. There was oasis here and there through the desert. But the at night then, the temperature we got plummeting down maybe to -2. And this was it, you see. I don't know how I account for it, you know, but from about 90 to about 30, we'll say.
I remember some buildings in outbuildings in a farm I worked for once, and they said that never go into them at night, you know. And I said, why? And they said, well, that was where a lot of these chaps were brought back, you know, as a mortuary and all that, you think. I didn't think very much about it. I had occasion to go up to the place because the alarm had gone off and there was nobody there. And I went into this place to check out what was going on, you know. And I have a vivid imagination, obviously, because the hair stood on my head on several occasions. And I was convinced that some still wandered about, but God help them. That's where they would have come into those buildings. Apparently the locals were able to tell us that it was a common thing for the bus to be brought here. They were crashed on coming in. Maybe it says it was coming across from America and they could have been exhausted or anything. But there was a lot of fatalities there. I was on Main Street, at the top of Main Street, and these Americans came up. And to me, at that age, they just ambled along, you know. And I was regimental boys of the Royal Artillery, and that had been in our town from really, really soldiers, I thought. And these chaps were waving at everybody and just started sauntering along, coming up the main street. So, but still, it was good to see them at that time. We got to know some of them very well.
That's right.
And,
Give us chocolate and chewing gum. Enormous.
Yeah. We lost our elder brother for about 3 days. Sorry.
See him for a while, you know.
I lost my elder brother for about 3 days and discovered he was in the mess along with the Americans getting fed. So this happened. So. And there was among them, there was one particular chap, and he must have been an Indian or of Indian extraction, because as he was talking to us just in the corner at the diamond, and a couple of the poles there were wooden poles in those days, and he drew this knife out. And he would walk back and he would chunk this knife into it and come back and tell us all about where he had been, who he was going to do, and all the rest of it. That went down very well with us wee lads. So.
That same man, Fred, after he went back to America after the war, sent a bouquet of flowers every Christmas.
Yeah.
She did a lot of sewing, and Fred's father and mother were both tailors, and she did a lot of work, doing uniforms and things like that, isn't that right?
That's right. The problem with that was when I came home from work, what left for me? Americans were here sitting, waiting on getting stripes sewn on their arms and their uniforms. The British Army wore a hat, same as a Home Guard hat, which I eventually had as well. And they thought these were lovely, and my mother eventually sort of formed these hats for them. And but they were great lads. We had some great fun with them. But they're in our house regularly because of all sorts of things.
We had a British Army sergeant billeted it in our house in Meadowbank Street, a Maltese sergeant, and his family billeted it on us in our home in Meadowbank Street. And I was very familiar with the Maltese British soldier with his Jerusalem artichokes. I was fascinated by what was a Jerusalem artichoke. I wonder, they ate them constantly. They billeted a Maltese family in our house. I was aware of what American soldiers looked like, but I didn't pass them close enough to ask them for any, which all other children would do, no doubt, or young ladies, no doubt as well, if they got anywhere near them. But I was too young to be near large numbers, or, you know, significant numbers of American soldiers.
Mrs. Briggs was the teacher, and she came in and announced to the kids that D-Day had started, that the invasion had started. And she was in tears and floods of tears because her brother was involved in it, you see, as well. So that's how I remember D-Day, Mrs. Briggs coming into the classroom to announce to the officers that the invasion had started.
But the Irish were in the airborne invaders that landed over the D-Day beaches and on into France. And they were in the morning. You know, they were one of the first to go in, so there would have been a lot of Irish people involved in that.
This was Operation Overlord, which was the D-Day invasion. There were several beaches, but the beach that we were on was Gold Beach. 21st Army and were 30 Corps, which was commanded by Lieutenant General Horrocks. We landed in D+2 in a place called BO. From there we went to Caen, and we went up through what they call the Falaise Gap, which was a battle fought there, and the dead were piled up all over the place. We broke out of that, and we then went through Belgium. We liberated some of the towns in Belgium.
In your report there, you said there was, they talked to you about cinemas and all that type of thing being closed down. Well, what happened during the 1944? The Americans, they had a great big projector, and they brought this projector in, and they showed these films, and it was all about the D-D landings of 1944, the 6th of June, 1944 landings. And we thought it was the greatest thing, you know, to see this in the pictures, you know, the landings of the... In fact, there was a terrible lot of ones from around Ballymoney and district was involved in the D-Day, you know, so we're always worried about them, you know, what was happening to them.
American reconnaissance tanks liberated us. We got the German guards' weapons, we kept them. They gave us some weapons, but told us to take charge of the village. It was only a small place, maybe a population of about 300. Had to take charge of the village and control all German prisoners of war. They were going through to a camp. Well, this lorry came in this day. Standing, I was a man alone. He was a bruiser anyway. I didn't know his name. We stopped this truck. There was an officer sitting in it, and I opened the door at the side, and I asked him to get out. And then the other boy said, "Get out." And he said, "No." And then I said to him, "Give me a pistol." No. Well, I pistol stood out of his holster. He was slack. He had the pistol down. If he'd have been a good soldier, he'd had it fastened, and nobody could have took it. And I just, he says, "SS." I says, "I know you're SS. I can see that by the badge in your cap, you're SS. Are you getting out?" And he says, "No." I'll get out of this. It's when an officer comes and addresses me, he says, you're only soldiers. So you're nothing, he said. You're only dirt. From me, he grabbed a pistol from me, and he caught him here at the top of the head, and right down the foresight, right down the side of his head, he says, "Get out now." He got out, blood pouring from him. So he says, "I'll report this." And the boy says, "You report away." He says, "Don't." He wanted to go on. And we said, "See what's in the bag of this." "Oh, no, you can't. Can't do that." I says, "We went round the back of the truck." With that, they gathered up, and we opened the back of the truck. It was all provisions. And he was taking that down into the car. And we said, "Not doing that." And the children of the village had never seen chocolate. They'd never seen an orange or banana. We just dumped the whole lot of, called them all out, and says, "Help yourselves." And that was dancing. And it was the best, I would say it was the best week they had for jokes. So, banana and orange.
But eventually, we found out the Russians. I can't remember. And that was at the end of the war. Now, we cross, but you could smell a bunch of bodies for a mile away. They dug the toilet out of the ground, dumped the bodies. There was worse, ostriches and all, and, but there was probably worse, you know, braille than that.
War who came home. I just remember the jollity the pupils and people had for him, the they had and the place they rated and they were up. Good feeling for me, although I did hear stories in my later life about how he had been very badly treated as a prisoner.
That was VE Day, you know. And again, he says there were parties for that. I remember the great white table line. Oh, it was all there. And that right there on all for that. And we had terrible, and it carried on maybe for about 2 years. You know, that's celebrating this great victory, you know.
People, we were gathering all sorts of stuff for bonfires. And I'm sure you remember the bonfires place. And he was down. When the war went over, that was. And they'd been gathering up the stuff for weeks and weeks beforehand, you know, to have it all.
They are. The street just completely chock-a-block. I remember my mother had some more and doors closed and anything. I went at 9 and lying on the floor, one above the other, and trying to go down the main street, you know, and move. It was just... And
wasn't selling on all night, you know. Quite at all. It was a terrific night.
I remember the town here in the street. Well, I wasn't that old, but I was dancing. That was so very merry.
Proudly painting the island on the wall. So that's my memory of the end of the war. With the British and French allies when we won the war. It was a great moment.
For me, war is so awful. And as a country end itself. I just can't find words to describe what I was killed in action, what thoughts I would have about the whole thing. I don't think I would see very much good in it.
Every year on November 11th, we take time to express a sense of respect and gratitude to those with hearts full of memories, those who will again. We will remember them.